A lot of work right now. And even with them, like,
Okay, thank you. So we got to the top of Tesvav and Min Aleph. I'm trying to reconcile apparently contradictory Mishnayos here in Masechus Yuma regarding the order of the lighting of the candles. Do we say like Abba Shaul that the Ketores is only after all seven candles have been lit? Or do we say like the Chachamim that you light five candles and then you light the burn the Ketores and then you light the additional two candles? So the last statement that we made was the pasuk says "Baboka baboka beitivos saneros yaktirena." It sounds like the Ketores comes afterwards, like Abba Shaul. So how did the Chachamim understand that? So "Banning my kama rachmana," top of Tesvav and Aleph, "Eden atava tehe mikta Ketores." That it means that when you're finishing up the cleaning of the candles in the morning, then the Ketores should already have been burned or be already burning. The dilote mahi, because if you don't learn like this pshat, bein habayim, so how are you going to translate the words in bein habayim when you have the candles lit in the afternoon? Everybody agrees that the last order of business is the lighting of the candles in the afternoon, in the late afternoon, before the evening, that has to be after the ketores. Despite the fact that the word yaktirena there is also written last, so it sounds like the Ketores goes last, but everybody agrees that the candles go last in the afternoon. So Hakinami, the Beresha, the Madlik Neus, Ohadir, Maktir Ketores, because if you're going to read the Pasuk literally, you'd have to read it as connoting that you light the candles before the Ketores, and that can't be. She'll be the Bahadur Maktir Ketores, she'll be in a Bain Bechitema, Hakinami, if you'll say that's true, that the Ketores, the afternoon Ketores is the last avodah after the candles. It's not true. We're telling you the Brisa says me'erva boker. The pasuk says yaroch oso Aaron ubanav me'erva boker lifnei Hashem, that Aaron and his sons shall set up the candles. Oso me'erva boker from the evening until the morning in front of Hashem. So that teaches us a couple of things. Number one, teaches us that there has to be enough oil for the candles to be able to last until the morning. That would be a chatzi lug, as we said, tein lamidasa shtei delekas v'lechas kol alayla me'erva boker, that even if it's a very long evening, like during the long nights of Tevis, it has to be able to last, so you make sure that it's a chatzi lug. Davar acher, and something else that we learn is me'erva boker, that me'erva boker teaches me that this is the last service of the day. Lighting of the candles is the last service of the day until the evening. There's nothing else that is appropriate to be performed after this is performed. Oh, so only this is done right before evening. Nothing else can be done right before evening, meaning that this takes place clearly after the Ketores, despite the fact that the word yaktirena appears last in the pasuk. So then how do you interpret the order of the pasuk? That when you're lighting the candles, there has to be a ketores which is already burning. So hakinami, the chachamim could say, it means the same thing over here as well with respect to the morning fixing of the candles. Beidin atava, when you're fixing up the candles, teimikta ketores, when you're fixing up the last two candles, so the ketores has already been burned. But Abba Shaul says the afternoon is different. Afternoon, we understand that the candles come last, that they get lit after the Ketores, because shiny osin siv oso, because it says in the pasuk yaroch oso avon uvanav me'er v'aboker lifnei Hashem, that it is an exclusion. It means only this avoda is done at the very end of the day and right before the evening, and no other avoda can be done right before the evening. But Papa said. That we can reconcile the two Mishnayos, namely our Mishnah, which indicates that the Ketores comes first, and the next Mishnah in Yuma, which indicates that the Ketores comes last, It doesn't have to be that one is talking about the five candles, one is talking about the two candles, and the whole thing is going like the Chachamim. We could say no, that I'm a lokasha, Rapapa, I'm a lokasha, have a button, Abashol, that when we indicate that the Ketairis comes last, that's going like Abashol. And when it indicates that the Ketairis comes first, at least before some of the candles, before two of the candles, that's going like the Chachamim. So that our Mishnah would be going like the Chachamim. So Mamayu Kimta the Masnis the Hakabon. So if that's the case, then he, what Papa is saying is that our Mishnah is actually going like the Chachamim. The next Mishnah is going like Abashol, Pious Ka Abashol, who says that the Ketairis comes last, meaning it comes after all of the candles. So Ema Sepa, but then there's yet another Mishnah. I mean, Sekhus Yuma goes on for a while. There's another Mishnah in the Lamed, that's Lamed Aleph, Lamed Beis. So we have our Mishnah in the Yuds, we have the second Mishnah in the Chofs, and we have a third Mishnah in the Lamed. And that Mishnah says, hey, Vilo is giving us the service of the day. You know, Kippur Vilo is a tummy. They bring the Korban tummy to the Kohen Gadol. He has to do all the avodas of the day, so he has to be very efficient. So Karzo, meaning that he only shecks the majority of the simonim of the animal, which is good enough to make it kosher, but he has to go quickly. The Umarak Acher Shkita Al Yodo, and somebody else stands there in order to receive the blood. Nichnas Lahakdir Es HaKetayris. And then he runs, the Kohen Gadol has to run and do everything on Yom Kippur. So he runs to burn the Ketairis. Here it looks like the Ketairis is going first. And that again is like the opinion of Abashol. Then afterwards he's going to fix the Neiros, presumably meaning the last two Neiros. This is going like the Chachamim, who say that the Neiros come after the Ketairis. So he's Niknas Laktiv as the Ketairis. He burns the Ketairis, and afterwards is going to fix the last two candles. So that's going like the Chachamim, Asan L'Rabbanan. So then it follows according to this opinion, namely of Rapapa, that Reisha V'Seipa Rabbanan, Mitziyasa Abashol, that the first Mishnah here, our Mishnah, is going like the Chachamim. The Ketairis is first. The Seipa is going like the Chachamim. The Ketairis is first, meaning at least before some of the candles. The Mitziyasa that says the Ketairis is last, which Rapapa is interpreting to mean after all the candles, is going like Abashol. That seems a little bit disorganized. So Amalak Rapapa, so Rapapa says, no, that's the way you have to understand it. Reisha V'Seipa Rabbanan, the first mission and the last mission going like the Chachamim, that the Ketairis interrupts between the first five candles and the last two candles. Mitziyasa Abashol, and the middle mission that indicates that the Ketairis comes after everything, is going like Abashol. So Bishlam Abaye, so we can understand why Abaye, who simply said that it's all going like the Chachamim, and when we talk about the Ketairis coming last, that's referring to after the first five candles. When the Ketairis comes first, that means the Ketairis is coming before the last two candles. So Bishlam Abaye Lo Amar Ke Rapapa Reisha V'Seipa Rabbanim Siyasa Abashol Lo Mukim Lo. Abaye wasn't comfortable saying that the Mishnayos are schizophrenic, that the first and last are going like the Chachamim, and the middle one is going like Abashol. Rapapa, my time alone, my Abaye. Rapapa, why didn't Rapapa say like Abaye that, you know, our Mishnah, the first Mishnah that indicates the Ketairis comes first, means just that it comes, you know, before two candles, the last two candles. And then the next Mishnah that says the Ketairis comes last means that it's coming after the first five candles, but before the next two candles. Why don't he say like Abaye? So we can say that everything is going like the Chachamim. The Papa, my time alone, my Abaye. So Malach Tan Vareisha Tavash Tenuas, the Tavahadach Tavash Chamesh Tenuas. That the order doesn't make sense. Our Mishnah that says the Ketairis comes first would have to say it's coming first before the last two candles. And then the next Mishnah, which talks about the Ketairis coming last, is talking about it's coming after, you know, after the first five candles. Why would I have the last two candles focused upon first, and then then the first five candles emphasized afterwards? It doesn't make sense. But Abaye Malach, Abaye says, no. The truth of the matter is that I have three Mishnayos. So the first Mishnah is just telling us in general, the Kohen Gadol for all of the 7 days before Yom Kippur prepares, you know, to do all of the different avodos. And it's just talking about that we teach the Kohen Gadol to do the general avoda. The general avoda involves cleaning up candles in the morning and also cleaning up the lamps. And also it involves burning the Ketairis. But we're not focusing so much on the order in the first Mishnah. The second Mishnah, it talks about the Ketores coming last, is talking about the five candles. You do the five candles, the five lamps, and then you do the Ketores. And then, you know, the last Mishnah, which is which is in the Lamed, which talks about the Ketores coming before the candles, is talking about how the Ketores comes before the last two candles. So it really is all in order. We have sort of the general Mishnah. It talks about the Kohen practices, you know, doing the Avodah in general. Then we talk about what happens with respect to the five candles. It's the five candles, and then there's the Ketores. Then we speak about what happens to the two candles. There's the Ketores, and then there's the two candles. So it really is all in order. And the order is really after the first Mishnah. So we start off with the general service of the Kohen Gadol, and then we talk about where the Ketores is in relation to the five candles, and then where the Ketores is in relation to two candles, and it's all going like the Chachamim. Because, of course, according to Abishal, the Ketores only comes after all seven candles, all seven lamps have been cleaned out. So Gufa, and what does it say? Balo the Keren Mizrachis at Sifonis. So we quoted the Mishnah in Tamid, that the service which is done with respect to the Korban Ola, the Ola's Tamid, right, every single day, is that the Kohen comes to, because we were talking about whether the Mishnayos and Tamid go like Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah or not, and we said it can't go like Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah, because Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah poses an objection or an alternative Shita to the Mishnah in Tamid. So we said, well, then the Mishnayos and Yuma are going like Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah. Okay, so Balo, so what did we say in terms of the Mishnah in Tamid, though, when we quoted it? Said that the Kohen goes to the north, the northeast corner, in order to sprinkle the blood of the Tamid. He does one sprinkling of blood on the two corners, and therefore it's one Matana that has that goes on two corners. Then he goes to the diagonal corner, the south west corner, and he sprinkles on that corner, and it goes in two directions. So Balo Kohen Mizrachis Tzafonis no same. So he gives one sprinkling, one dabbing that goes in the north end of the east side. Maravis Deromis, and it goes to the diagonal side in the southwest corner. And no saying Maravis Deromis, and he gives one a sprinkling, which sprinkles to the west and to the south. The Tani Allah. And on that, Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah, indicating he wasn't the Tana, because he says something about this, which is oppositional. So I think yesterday I read Mishnah B'Tami, because it is a Mishnah B'Tami that we're commenting upon, but I didn't think that really read straight. So it's actually not probably the right reading. Should be Mishanet B'Tamid. He says that the Korban Tamid is not like other Korban Olos. The Korban Tamid has a special rule that it's really like three sprinklings, that you sprinkle one time in the northeast corner, and then you sprinkle two times in the southwest corner. Balo, the Keren Mizrachis Tzvonis, no same Mizrachis Tzvonis, is one sprinkling on the northeast corner, and then Mamaris Tzvonis has two sprinklings, like a Korban Chatas. You know, you have to sprinkle four times in all four corners, so you have to soak here too. On the one corner where you have supposed to get the two sides, the south and the west, so you sprinkle two times, one for the south and one for the west. No saying Marava. First you give on the west because he's coming down westward. No saying Droma, and then he sprinkles on the south, which is the last side that he confronts.
It's funny in the beginning.
Yeah, the first one is northeast, and it's just one sprinkling. One sprinkling. Yeah. He takes the kli and he pours it one time. Right, then when he's up in the north, so then he's going from east to west and on the north side, and then he's going down on the west side from north to south, and then he turns from the south to go towards the south side, right. So therefore, he's going to confront the west side first, then the south side. So my time at the Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah. What's the reason Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah to do it a strange way? It's like three sprinklings, one on the northeast corner, and then two separate sprinklings on the west side, and then on the south side. So I'm Rabbi Yochanan Mishim Chadabei Rabbi Yanai. Yochanan quoted something from the base manager Rabbi Yanai Amakra, because the pasuk when it talks about the kabbonos of Rosh Chodesh. So it says you bring a chatas, and this chatas is kind of like being done like the ola. And the ola that we're talking about is the ola's tamid. So therefore, it's telling us something about how you bring the tamid. You do it like the ola. So ola he, so that's weird, because it's saying that the way in which you do the chatas is kind of like the way that you do the tamid. It says ola satamin yeah seven is go. The ola should be done like the chatas. So, but it's an ola. So which is it? Are you doing like an ola? Are you doing like a chatas? A chatas, you have a separate sprinkling for each side. So haketzad, so no saying achas yishtayim k'maisa ola. So you do both. You one sprinkling, you do like a regular ola. A regular ola is one sprinkling on a corner, which counts for the, which goes on the two different sides. That's what you're going to do on the northeast side. And then when you go to the second side, the southwest side, then you're going to do it more like a chatas, so you have a separate sprinkling for each side. You're going to take the kli and splash it, you know, on each side. Shtaim shehen shtaim k'maisa chatas. Litein shtaim, why don't you just go do two separate series of sprinklings? Litein shtaim shehen ava k'maisa ola. I have one, it's a sprinkling where you go first, sprinkle once, you splash the blood once on the northeast side, and then you splash the blood and it goes on both corners. And then you splash the, you splash it on the northeast corner and goes on both sides. Then you splash on the southwest corner and it goes on both sides. Do it like that. We think the way that you would do a normal ola. And then do like a chatas and go around the entire mizbeach and sprinkle on all four sides. So the Gemara says, you can't do like two series of sprinklings. Once you've done one series, you're done. And the second series doesn't count for anything. We don't find that you can, you know, sprinkle, throw blood for one korba in a full way and then do it, you know, a second time around. It doesn't work that way. Well, if you think that's strange, this is also strange. It's strange to have sprinklings where the first, you know, the first sprinkling splashing is done like an ola, and the second one is done like a chatas. That's also weird. Rather, we see that there is some sort of a hekish. There's some sort of a comparison which is being drawn between the ola and the chatas in these psukim regarding the korbanos that are brought on Rosh Chodesh. So hakinami bal kocha and occasion hakasuf. So it's the same one way or another. We're going to have to have some sort of a blending of an ola and a chatas. So we say no hasam pisuk matanas biyamahi. Say no, it's not as clear when you're doing it the way that we suggested, that you have one one sprinkling of the blood on the northeast corner, which is done one time and it splashes on both sides. So, you know, that sounds like an ola. And then when you get to the other side, the southwest corner, and you just happen to splash, you know, twice. So it doesn't, since it's being splashed on one corner and if you're not going to all four corners, so it just looks like you're, you know, interrupting a little bit, you know, the regular the splashing of the blood of the ola, but it doesn't quite look like the splashing of a korban chatas if you're not going around to all four corners of this mizbeach. It's just a slight interruption in the splashing. It's pisuk matanas biyami. B'nesav achas yishtayim lamata. But wait a second, an ola is generally splashed below the chuta sikra on the lower portion of the mizbeach, and the chatas is poured on the is sprinkled on the upper part of the mizbeach. So why don't we do like that? Why don't we say shtaim menesiv akashi shtaim lemata kamase ola, that you should have with the one one splashing should be on the bottom of the mizbeach like a maisa ola, and shtaim shein shtaim lemala, and then when you go to the southwest corner and you're going to splash twice, then you should splash on the upper part of the mizbeach. We do it, of course, do it completely like a chatas, right? So we say lo matzina dami shekasi lemala v'kasi lemata. We don't find any kind of sprinkling or splashing of blood where you do half of it on the top of the mizbeach and half on the bottom of the mizbeach. So therefore, since it's fundamentally an ola, all of the splashing is going to be on the bottom of the mizbeach, even the southwest corner, we're going to splash twice. Below, is that true that you don't find that you ever do like a partial splashing on the top and a part on the bottom? That's not, but then we have a Mishnah later on, also Masechus Yuma, that says that with respect to like the sprinkling of the blood of the par of the Kohen Gadol, right? And the same thing with the seer of the seer of the Hashem, which the Kohen Gadol brings, we say that when he's standing next to the Kaporis, you know, in the Kodesh HaKadoshim, so he spills one upward, one placement of blood goes upward, and the seven of them go downward. Right, so it sounds a little bit like there, where that the one that would be upward would be like on the upper half of the own area, and that the seven on the bottom would be on the bottom half. So we see that we do sometimes separate within one sprinkling of blood between the top part and the bottom part. So we say no, it doesn't mean that we're separating between the top part and the bottom part. It's just the manner in which the blood gets sprinkled kematzlif. It just means that it's done like a person would be whipping when you whip. So you go gradually downward as you're whipping, you know, the lashes on the individual's back. My kamat sleep, what does kamat sleep mean? Machli Rabbi Yehuda show kimnagdina. That's like a shliach bezdin when he's whipping with a whip. So he doesn't only whip in one place. He just like whips, you know, further down each time. But it doesn't mean that you're separating between an upper half and a bottom half below. But we don't find another example of this. But there is a Mishnah also later on. We have tonight. He's a menu atavashem is back. That you take the blood, you mix together the blood of the power and the seer, and the Kohen Gadol mixes it, and then he sprinkles it al taro shel mizbeach. What is taro shel mizbeach? It sounds like in the middle of the mizbeach. Like taro means like the sunniest time of the day. The taro of the day is the tzaharayim. It's like the middle of the day. It's called the taro shel yom. So that's what we refer to as like noon is taro. Shere pami, my lava pagi the mizbeach. That means she taro tiara. But doesn't it mean that he sprinkles the blood on the midsection of the mizbeach, the midsection of the mizbeach. If you're going to sprinkle there, so some Rashi says invariably some of the sprinklings will land on the top of the middle, and some of them, you know, a little bit below the middle, because they're not all going to isha ir. So it's not saying they're not all going to be exactly in the middle. So some will be a little bit above, some will be a little bit below. So we see such a thing. Because just like we say, Tara Tira, hu pahaga diyoma, that the expression Tara Tira is talking about the middle of the day. So too, presumably, this means that you're sprinkling in the middle of the Mizbeach Azar. So I'm a Rabbi Bashela. No, lo, agufe, turn the page. Agufe the Mizbeach. We're talking about on the top of the Mizbeach, because the word Tar, and that's what we generally assume, it can mean that it's like the clearest portion of what we're talking about. A tohar means ke'etzem ha'shemayim l'tohar, the clouds clear away, and now you can see everything 100% clearly. The ksivu ke'etzem ha'shemayim l'tohar said here too as well, the ketores have been burned on the top of the mizbeach hazav, Rashi explains, and the ketores gets cleared away. So now the area has been become tohar. It has become, you know, cleared away. And at that point that it becomes cleared away, the coals are raked from the to this side and to that side, that's when you pour the blood on that upper cleared portion of the mizbeach. But it doesn't mean the middle of the mizbeach. So we don't find any case where you're sprinkling blood where some goes on the above the middle section, some goes below the middle section. So therefore, that's why we don't do that here either. So Mishna, the yayv olive ratio, how the yayv chata v'chatas. Why is it that when you're doing these sprinklings, again, according to this opinion of Rabbi Shimon Ish Hamitzvah, that you're pouring, you know, the in an Ola fashion on the northeast side, and then sort of in a Chatas fashion with two separate sprinklings on the Mizbeach, splashings on the Mizbeach on the southwest side. So why do you do the Ola type splashing first of one splashing on the northeast side and then a Chatas style afterwards on the southwest side of two separate splashings? Nesa Bereisha, the Chatas, rather than Nesa the Ola. Why don't you do the Chatas one first and then the Ola one first? Why don't you do it, you know, in that fashion? So we say, no, Kiman the Ola, we have to highlight what this Korban really is. We're talking about the Korban Tamid, Korban the Shel Shachar. Korban Tamid Shel Shachar is an Ola. Kiman the Ola, we're going to burn the whole thing, all the Yivarim, all the limbs on the Mizbeach. It's an Ola. Kiman the Ola, he Korban Bereisha. So the Ola style sprinkling, notwithstanding the Hekesh in the Pasuk, they have to do it a little bit like a Chatas, according to his opinion. The Ola style has to come first. Why is it that we start in the northeast side and then go to the southwest side? Why don't we do on the southeast side instead of the southwest side? We could do the southeast side, and then we could do the northwest side. Why don't we do the other two diagonals rather than northeast and the southwest? Why don't we do the word Vahadar according to the box should be deleted? So well, never mind the order, but why don't we use these two different corners? Why don't we do the southeast side and the northwest side? So Ami Ola Tuna Yesod, because it's because the an Ola requires a Yesod. It requires that when you're going to be splashing the blood, there has to be a base there on the Mizbeach. And we have a tradition that there was no base on the southeast corner. The Karen Dromis Mizrach is Lavale Yesod. That the entire, you know, south side and east side did not really have a base. There were bases on all of the three corners, but from the corners to the south side, and then going to a southern, on the southerly direction and the eastern direction, the one no corners, and the one place of the four different quadrants that didn't have a corner altogether was the south, the east portion. And as we have mentioned previously, that all belonged to the chelek of Yehuda as opposed to Binyamin, and therefore there was no physical mizbeach, including no physical base in that area. And since the ola has to be sprayed in an area of the blood has to be sprayed where there is a yesod, therefore, it, practically speaking, this corner cannot be used. So once the corner, the south, the east corner couldn't be used, so the northwest diagonal couldn't be used either. So maishna, because you have to get two diagonal sides in order to get all four directions. So maishna, the yoy beresha, mizrachus, tzafonis. So why are we starting? Given that you have to spray on those two corners, on the northeast corner and on the southwest corner, why does the northeast corner come first? Why don't we say the southwest corner should come first, right? Why do we go Mizrachis, Tzafonis, northeast, Vahada, Maravis, Adramis, and then afterwards southwest? Why don't we start with the southwest corner and then go to the northeast corner? So came in the Mamar, no, because when the Kohen typically walks up the Mizbeach, now for Nola, he's walking around the Mizbeach. He's not going up the ramp, but typically the way that you would approach the Mizbeach. So this is sort of our guidepost is by going up at the ramp. So when he opens, when he enters the ramp goes from the south side to the north side. And then once he hits sort of like that midsection of Mizbeach, when he's going from south to north, and now he's on the, he's on the south side of the Mizbeach, but he's heading in a northward direction. So now he has to turn to go around the Mizbeach. Which way is he going to turn? Is he going to turn to his left, in which case he's going to go towards the west side? Or is he going to turn to his right, in which case he's going to go towards the east side? So we have a general rule that we derive from various psukim. So Amamar Kopinos Sheatapone, that whenever you're going to turn to do a mitzvah, particularly in the Beis Hamikdash, when there is a need to turn in a particular direction, that whenever you turn, you have to turn in an eastward direction. Once he's going to turn in an eastward direction, he's going to go towards the east side of the Mizbeach. So then he's going to keep on walking in this sort of counterclockwise direction. When he walks in this counterclockwise direction, he's going to go to the east side, and then he's going to keep on turning. When he keeps on turning, he's going to head towards the northeast side. So that's going to be the direction that he's going to hit before he hits the southwest side. Yes.
I'm not sure. I think earlier we said that the Mizbeach, we go first to Mizrachim, then we go Maravit, and then we go Dromit, which is left.
No. But once he starts walking, he's turning to his right. So in other words, he's walking up the ramp. When he walks up the ramp, so
giving in the northeast, then you go.
Right. At that point, he's walking counterclockwise. At that point, he's walking. Right. But when you're going counterclockwise, you're starting off going to your right. But then you have no choice. You just have to continue along that direction. We don't care how you're going at this point in time. Because you're not going to go backwards. So once you start going in the right direction, when you get to the south side of the Mizbeach, you turn to your right and then you just keep on walking. We don't care at that point in time. It's all based on a trip that began on the right side. The main thing that we're focused on is how does the trip begin? Once the trip begins, so then you just follow along afterwards. It doesn't matter what direction you're going afterwards. We consider it all to be right because it all started from a rightward direction. Okay. So therefore, that's why he ends up hitting the northeast corner first. So that's the one. Since you have to go, so he's going to end up hitting the northeast corner first. And how do we know from the pasuk that we were quoting before with respect to Alolasa Tamid, Yeyasev in Isko, that we're speaking about, you bring the chatas, and then we say, and that chatas is Al Olasa Tamin Yeyasev in Isko, so that we have this juxtaposition between the Katas and the Ola. So we said we learned from there that the Ola has to be done a little bit like a Katas. So why did we learn it that way? Why didn't we learn it the other way? Maybe it's the other way around. You should do a Katas the way that you would do an Ola. So say, Lo Sakadai Tekksiv Al Olas Hatamid Ye Aseh Benisko. That the Asiya that we're talking about is an Asiya of the Ola. And therefore it's the Ola that has to be done like the Katas. Maikama Rahmana Midi the Katas Shadi Ola. What the Torah is basically saying is that which you would normally do for the Katas, Al Ola Satamid, put that on the Ola, put that type of sprinkling, put that type of the way that you would do this Rika Saddam, put that upon the Ola so that the Ola will be splashed, the blood of the Ola will be splashed in a fashion similar to the Chadas. Tranas in the Mishnah. Now, why are we quoting this other Mishnah? Because we're on a roll, so we're quoting Mishnayos. But we had said that there were sort of contradictions in the Mishnayos. We wanted to explain that one set of Mishnayos was going like a particular Tana. It was going like Rabbi Shimon Isha Mitzvah. So do we have other examples where we say that type of distinction, where we have contradictions between Mishnayos, and we say, well, one of them is going like a particular Tana. So that's why we're bringing this to show like a similar type of limud. Amalem Amamuna, we have a Mishnah. This is in Tamid. The Mishnah in Tamid says, Amalem Amamuna, that the one who's in charge of the service in the base of Mikdash, the director says, okay, it's time to get started. We have to bring the korban tamid. Bring a ewe, bring a lamb from the chamber of the lambs. So it's not a kasha. Here, Rashi says it's bahare. And where was the lishka satlaim? Lishka satlaim was haisa mitzvah marabis. It was in the northwest corner of the, there was a giant chamber called the chamber of the Beis HaMokad, where the Kohanim would go to warm themselves. There were lots of fires there. They would warm themselves because they had to walk barefoot around the Beis HaMikdash, so the feet would get cold. So they would go to warm themselves. And in that giant chamber of the Beis HaMokad, there were like four, there were four corners, and there was a tiny, and there was a smaller chamber in each one of those four corners in the Beis HaMokad. So one of those chambers, the chamber on the northwest side, was the Lishka Satlaim, was the chamber of the lambs. Rabba Lishka Sayusham, there were four different chambers in the giant chamber of the Beis HaMokad. There were four little, smaller chambers in the four corners. Achas Lishka Satlaim, one of them on the southwest, on the northwest side, was the chamber of the lambs on the northwest side. Achas Lishka Satlusamas, and another one was Lishka, where they would give out Chosamas, they would give out cards, stamps to people who would buy Nesachim for different types of animals. You had to pay different amounts depending on whether you bought a par or whether you bought an ayal or whether you bought a kevis. There were different amounts of nesachim, and you would pay your amount and you would get your card, and then you would bring your card to the place where they gave out the actual nesachim, and you would get the nesachim that you needed. And then there was one chamber which was like a miniature Beis HaMokad, a miniature place with the fire for people to, for the Kohanim to warm themselves. The whole thing was a Beis HaMokad, but this was like, you know, a miniature area within the Beis HaMokad, of like a private section of where one could warm themselves. And one of them was the chamber where they would prepare the lechem apanim that was baked each week for the 12 loaves for that would be baked and then from one Shabbos to the next Shabbos. But we have in Maseches Midos a contradictory Mishnah that seems to say that the chambers that were inside this giant Beis HaMokad, the chamber of fire, that the four little chambers on the corners were, four small chambers on the corners, were actually different, that they weren't identical. Two of them were the same and two of them were different. Kikitonia Subsilicus the Traklin, it was like, you know, you have a little porch area that leads to the palace. So here too as well, you had like, you know, these little tiny, you know, chamber areas that, you know, led to the larger area. Shtayim Bekodesh, Shtayim Bechol. Two of them were in the sanctified area of the Azara, and two of them were outside of the Azara. Roshi Pispisim Mevdil Min Kodesh Lechol, the little twigs of wood that would divide between the area that was consecrated and the area that wasn't consecrated. So those that could be in one area, not the other, would know where the dividing line was. Umayyim Hasham shows, and what were they used for? So we see that here, we don't have them used for the same four identical uses. in the description of Maseches Midos. Maharavi said Daromis, he hiked up the southwest corner, was the Lishka Satalei HaKorban, was the Lishka of the Talaya Korban, was where the lambs were kept. And where do we say the lambs were kept? We said the lambs were kept in the northwest corner. And here we're saying it was the southwest corner. So there's a contradiction between Maseches Tamid and Maseches Tamid. And Maseches Midos. Dramis Mizrachi, see Lishka Shayosim Alechem upon him. The south, the east corner was where the lechem upon him was baked. Mizrachi's Tzfonis, so they did have one, you know, corner, one of the chambers in the corners was used to lechem upon him. That's similar. And the other two were not similar at all. Mizrachi's Tzfonis, the northeast corner, Bargansu based Kashmunai, and Mizbek Shiksu Machi of the Kukharim. That's where the Machos based Kashmunai. They stored the original stones of the Mizbeach, which were rendered invalid by being used for Avodah Zarah purposes by the Malchus Yavon, the idolatrous Malchus that came in and spoiled the Beis HaMikdash and desecrated the Beis HaMikdash. Sephonis Maravis in the northwest corner, Bar Yordan, the Beis HaTfilah, that's where the Kohen would go down to the Beis HaTfilah to immerse himself. So we see that there's a totally totally different description of the four different chambers. The two of them were totally different purposes, and the one that was the chamber of the lambs was in a different direction, because in Maseches Tamid we said that it was in the north, it was in the northwest corner, and here in Maseches Midos we say that it was in the south, the southwest corner. So rather than be in the northwest corner, it was in the southwest corner. So it's a totally, you know, different location. So Amafuna Mantana Midos. So Afuna says, no, that's because Midos was taught by a totally different Tana than the Tana who taught Talmud. You know, Talmud is probably Rabbi Yehuda Nasi who, you know, compiled most of the Mishnayos, but Midos was compiled by Rabbi Eliezer ben Yaakov. And Rabbi Eliezer ben Yaakov has a different version. So therefore, that's why there is a different accounting of where the chamber was located, and we will stop here. Okay, welcome to you.